Mr. India took it from there. You know the movie Mr. India. He became invisible whenever he wants, he can come back. But the advantage in such science fiction, it is so obviously impossible that people know it is impossible. So they enjoy reading it without getting confused. I'm not so sure about Michael Crichton. He has written some wonderful books like Andromeda Strain, which has been made into a movie, where there's an outbreak of a deadly epidemic from an extraterrestrial organism. Jurassic Park, based on genetic engineering. Of course, plausible, this is plausible science, it's not. But he also wrote a book called The Prey. Some of you might have read the book, in which, you know, a defense lab, private lab, defense research lab is asked to make a replica of a man belonging to a foreign organization so that this person, humanoid, can go and enter organization. But unfortunately, some lady in that organization teaches him how to reproduce. And then it turns back on the creator. Who is our epic man? Bakasura. And then, of course, Mr. Rambo type comes and knocks him off. But here, this created such a confusion that in the UK and US governments began to think whether they should ban nanobiotechnology. They asked for the Royal Society to form a committee to look at that. Fortunately, like, you know, many people don't worry about artificial intelligence, whether it should be take over the human race. But very clearly, like Roger Penrose says, to apply what is called the Gödel's incompleteness theorem, proposed by Gödel, which has never been disproved. No product can be smarter than the creator. So I think I belong to that group. Should be no curb on artificial intelligence. As David Kirby is a geneticist, is the sound coming okay? Okay. You see, a good science film should have moments where science has been done right. This Stanley Kubrick film, which is very famous in Space Odyssey, 2001. In order to show gravity does not exist in a spaceship, they created an artificial gravity wheel, centrifugal force most. And he spent a lot of money doing that. And I told you about The Beautiful Mind. John Nash, of course, was a genius. You can't, no actor can write the equations like obviously John Nash could write. So they got a hand double, they got a good mathematician and asked him to write the equations. Only the hand was shown, man. Otherwise, he said, we know the duplicates for actors in tough, but here it was. Anyway, Parmanu also had some of these. Next one, please. Coming back to the theme of my talk, can I have the next slide? See, this is what was mentioned. The report for the Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency. What they say is that two of the greatest challenges of the 21st century are going to be energy security and climate change. Energy security in the context of climate change. Of course, you have to how to mitigate it and how then to adapt to it and so on. Next one, please. This is the fifth assessment report, and they talk with, and this IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change, once in 5-6 years they give an assessment report, and here they mention that from the pre-industrial period to 2012, the world on an average is warmed by something like slightly less than 1 degree. Amounts of snow and ice have diminished, sea level has risen and so on. And if you want to cut down further global, too much of global warming, limit it to 2 degrees. Limit it to 2 degrees, which will require, see, the carbon dioxide that you emit, and of course, it goes and settles upstairs, prevents infrared radiation from the earth to go back into space. That is why this global warming occurs. So you have to cut down on energy producing systems, electricity supply systems which emit carbon dioxide, which means cutting down on fossil fuel burning. That's why they say you must increase renewable energy. The government has taken a very major initiative on international solar alliance. Nuclear we must do, carbon capture and storage, bioenergy, trees capture carbon dioxide, but it's a long-term one. But more recently, in October last year, IPCC meeting in Korea recommends limiting even lower, otherwise particularly the low-lying island states will get submerged. Parts of our country, coastal regions may go down underwater. Of course, this is a statement by the International Atomic Energy Agency that the nuclear power plants which are working together, total they are working today, the amount of carbon dioxide they cut down is equivalent to removing over 400 million cars from the roads. 400 million cars which they emit the carbon dioxide, equivalent to having all this power. Next one, please. Can I have the next slide, please? This is our three-stage nuclear program. Started with pressurized heavy water reactors which uses natural uranium as fuel. And that burns really this uranium-235, which is less than 1%. That's the one that burns there. Plutonium that is produced in the reactor goes to the second stage, the breeder reactors, sorry. The breeder reactors, first, but the fast breeders doesn't mean they breed fast. Breeder using fast neutrons. Heavy water reactors use thermal neutrons, which have been brought down in energy. And thorium, which is not a fissile material, but if you put it into the reactor, it gets converted to uranium-233. That will be our third stage. And at the same time, we will import light water reactors. We already have some from Russia and Kodakulam, what we call the VVR-1000. Next one. Next slide, please. These are all the reactors of the moment. Aurora, Rajasthan, Gurdas. Kaika is very near Goa, Karwar, very proximate to you. And at the moment, we have 22 reactors producing a total of about 6,800 megawatt of electricity. Next one. And the projects under construction that you can see there, Kodankulam, Kukrapar, Gorakhpur, Rajasthan, and that adds up to 9 reactors, 6,700 megawatt. Next one. See, we have very much concerned about safety, and we have an operational safety mission visiting our Rajasthan reactors some time back, 2012, and Rajasthan 3 and 4. And you see their comment which is given on the top. Open communication, enthusiasm, motivation, and sense of ownership were observed at all levels during the OSART mission. These attributes have cultivated an environment of strong safety culture at the Rajasthan reactor. In fact, this is true of any institution. If you love your institution, whether it's school, or the college, or your lab, you must have a sense of ownership. You think that belongs to you. Then you will keep it clean, you will keep it in good condition, you will not do anything which will harm it either physically or its reputation. So safety and reliability, whether you're driving a car or operating a reactor, safety and reliability go together. The more reliable, more reliable, the higher is the safety. And as an example of the reliability of our heavy water reactors, you see the last one here. On December 10, 2018, Unit 1 of the Kaiga Generating Station completed 941 days of continuous operation and set a world record, not only about heavy water reactors, but among all reactors in the world. Is it an occasion for clapping? Now we hold a world record as far as operating, reliable operation of a nuclear power plant is concerned. Of course, another 20 days that they shut it down. Next slide, please. For the first time, the government has approved the construction of 10 reactors at one stroke. The Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, 700 megawatts. Because, you know, unless you do that, if you give one by one, industry is not prepared. If you give a bunch lump order, then they can set up an assembly line, train the people. So, and these are the 10 reactors which are going to be built along with these two light water reactors of 1000 megawatts. When all this is over, then we'll have something like 22,500 megawatts by 2031. Next one, please. Then also, you know, we have somewhat lesser experience with light water reactors, so we are signing an in-principle agreement with these three countries, USA, France and Russia, and of course additional Vimpur. All these will also come. So there is now a strong momentum in the development of nuclear power in the country. Next one. Next slide, please. This is the prototype Pasteur reactor. The plutonium that is produced in heavy water reactors, now we are going into stage 2. And this is what it looks like. Near the coast, near Chennai, at this place called Kalbakkam. Next one. See, the advantage is, as many of you know, uranium 99% plus is uranium-238. And uranium-238 isotope is not a nuclear fuel. Only the 235 isotope is a nuclear fuel. But if you keep it inside a reactor, picks up a neutron, emits two beta particles, which electrons when they come out, atomic number goes up, becomes a different element, plutonium, with a one higher mass number. That can be used in what is called the fast breeder reactors. This is what is called closing the nuclear fuel cycle. Take the reprocess from the spent fuel, take out the plutonium, which is a very valuable material, put it back into new kinds of reactors. If you are able to do this, the same amount of uranium will give you 50 times more power. 50 times more power, because you are recycling instead of throwing away valuable material as you would do in an open cycle, which India has never favored. Now, in the fast breeder, if you put thorium, take the uranium-233 out, also use the thorium-uranium-233 cycle, the same starting uranium will give you 600 times more power. So I remember many years back I was mentioning our three-stage program to Dr. Muhammad El Barade, Mohammad was the Director General of IAS that time. Then he said, shall we then call nuclear as a renewable energy? Why you are getting so much? I said, let us be a little modest, we'll call it near renewable. And do you, how many of you know solar is nuclear energy? How many? Not many. Solar energy is actually fusion energy to start with. By the time it comes here, you call it solar energy. So you are using solar energy, nuclear energy, without sometimes knowing about it. Next one, please. But nuclear has applications, as I said, in all kinds of fields, sometimes unexpected also. Mangoes. If you want to delay the ripening of Alfonso mangoes, irradiate it. You can delay the ripening. That is the reason why we are able to export Alfonso mangoes to United States. Otherwise, by the time it goes by ship, it would get reduced. And when you expose seeds to radiation, there are mutations. And of course, we cannot control this random mutations. Then you go on watching, some of them are very favorable mutations. Some of the new varieties may have increased productivity. Some of the new varieties may have a resistance to pests. And if you do that for 7 generations to make sure that the mutation is stable, then you release it into the market. I think something like 90% of Buddha that is taken in Maharashtra is Trombe varieties. 10% of groundnut in the country is Trombe variety. Food security and productivity. Of course, radiation, somebody has a thyroid problem. Best method is to give him a glass of water containing radioactive iodine. Take a scan. Perfectly harmless. And you know if he has thyroid intake is proper or not. Suppose somebody unfortunately has cancer, one of the methods is killing the cancer cells by gamma radiation. Of course you can also kill by X-ray. That machine is built by Bach. And I think 40 of them have been sold now. It's called a Bhavatron. Or cancer treatment by radiation. Desalination plant. So there's practically, I'll give an example even in, for next slide please, in rural application. See this one. See in Uttarakhand, my friend Anil Joshi is actually a botanist. But he gave up all this and went over and decided I'll do rural development. He said he has an organization called HESCO, Himalayan Environmental Studies and Conservation Organization. In the lecture he was giving, he said, in hilly areas in Uttarakhand, water runs away downhill very fast. And then they have shortage of water in the after the rainy season is over. So they build on top of the hills what they call khals or ponds for rainwater harvesting. And this water reaches through broken rock to the villages where the aquifers are located. Anil Joshi mentioned, but the problem is when I build the khal, I don't know water will go to village located aquifers or will it run away to useless places? Who do I know? If the second thing happens, all the effort is a waste. So we brought in the BRC guys. They have a technique called isotope hydrology, which measure this oxygen 18 content in oxygen, heavy hydrogen content in hydrogen, radioactive tritium content, all water that you can drink contains a little bit of radioactive tissue, harmless, partly produced by cosmic rays from good heavens, also by the atmospheric hydrogen bomb tested by the bad guys. We tested it underground. And then they said, water is trying to flow this way. You see the white things over there, subsurface dikes. You put the dikes there, water will flow the way you want. And sure enough, in the Gaucher area of Uttarakhand, there have been, the average recharge of the aquifers went up by 3 times. And this one which you see here had dried up for a long time. It has come back. It has come back. And buffaloes have come back. You know, buffaloes need a bath more than us. Otherwise they fall sick. That's why you find them wallowing in water. Water went down, buffaloes gone. Water came back, buffaloes have come back. And it's good for rural economy, because then the children can get milk, they can also. Cattle economy is very important for rural. Next slide, please. Of course, nuclear is also weapons. The morning when the children, when I was talking, I showed this slide. This is a cartoon from Hindustan Times, predating our nuclear test. And he is a brash fellow, Western guy, in the suit, telling our guy with the Gandhi cap, who is obviously an Indian, why do you want the bomb? You cannot have the bomb. And the white cap tells the suit, if I had the bomb, you wouldn't talk to me like this. This is the cartoon which he had. Of course, this is a joke, but more seriously, national strength and national development are two sides of the same coin. The greatest advantage of recognized strength is you don't have to use it. That's the principle of deterrence, and now we have that deterrence. And the next slide shows, there is a next slide, please. Can I have the next slide? See, all these people who had nuclear weapons, but this is a Venn diagram, as you all teachers know, Venn diagram, and the two things overlap, knowledge transfer, that's what is indicated. All of them have shared for various, Russia to China, China to Pakistan, South Africa and Israel. Actually, they carried out an atmospheric test. There's a satellite the Americans had called the Vela satellite, Vela. See, when an atmospheric explosion takes place, nuclear, it's a big flash, and then the plasma expands, and at critical size, all the radiation coming out is blanked out. Then it gets more dilute, and again the peak comes. So the Vela satellite picks up with a time sequence that double peak guarantees it is a nuclear explosion atmospheric. But after having announced it, the Americans realized, done by their friends, Israel and South Africa. So they announced, no, it was not, it was Aurora Borealis. So they blanked it out, thereafter it was. In any case, later South Africa gave up its nuclear weapons, joined the NPT as a non-nuclear weapons team. But that's not the theme of Maya, they let them do what they want. But as you see here, India stands alone. What they have said is, India has not stolen knowledge from anybody or tried to transfer knowledge from anybody. And this is written by a couple of Americans after our Pokhran test. Another clap. Next slide, please. See, this is why we try to keep. I talk to people here who have been to Kaiga plant, we keep it very clean. Every tree we cut, we replace it with 10 trees in the nuclear power plant of the same type. Beautiful, greenery is beautiful. And next one, look at the birds from various nuclear power plants. That means place is very nice. You can also see butterflies. Butterflies don't like radiation. And if you find butterflies, that means the place is also radiation clean. Next one. See, to tell you the fundamentals, this is fission and this is fusion. Neutron enters the uranium-235 nucleus, gets in, becomes an excited nucleus, which is uranium-236. Then it breaks up. This is a typical pair of fission products. There can be any number of varieties there. It also emits 2 to 3 neutrons. And if you add up these masses of all those which are shown in the lower row, and take the mass of neutron plus uranium-235, there is a mass deficit. And you apply good old Einstein equation, E is equal to mc squared. And that is what is nuclear energy, fission energy. Create a mass deficit. You can do it in fusion by fusing deuterium and tritium, which are isotopes of hydrogen. You produce a neutron and a helium. And if you do that, there is a mass deficit. And that energy is nuclear energy, fusion energy, because there are other possible reactions over there. These are the two types of nuclear energy which we have. Next one. See, there is a big project coming up in France, Cadarache. It's called the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor. They are trying to build up a 500 megawatt fusion reactor. See, for the reaction I showed you on the right, deuterium and tritium getting together, you have to raise the temperature of the plasma to 100 million degrees, thereabouts, 100 million.